Hi, welcome to Brief Brain Facts. We are discussing opioid abuse and opioids on the brain. Now, keep in mind, this is a sensitive topic for some, but we still think it's a really important topic to discuss. And with that being said, let's just get started. Labeled as the worst drug crisis in American history, in 2015, the opioid epidemic claimed over 30,000 lives. And from all accounts, that number is not declining. Opioid is commonly used as an umbrella term to include opiates, which are naturally derived from the opium poppy plant. Such drugs include heroin and morphine. Traditionally, opioids are synthetically derived drugs that are created in a laboratory without the use of the poppy plant, but act on the nervous system in a similar fashion. These synthetically derived drugs are what people are usually prescribed, and they include drugs like Percocet and oxycodone. Both opiates and opioids are a class of drug that are used as analgesics, or pain relievers. They may also create a sense of well-being and euphoria. The human body creates opioids naturally, and these naturally created opioids are known as endorphins. However, before we get to how opioids act on the central nervous system, the brain and spinal cord, let's back up and look at our brain at the cellular level. Generally, our brain consists of two cell types: glial cells, cells that support by nourishing and insulating the second cell type, neurons. Neurons are cells that communicate with each other in order to promote a change or response brought about by thoughts, actions, and/or sensory information. Messages transfer in the form of electricity from neuron to neuron, from the cell body of the neuron to the axon, where at the end of the axon is the synapse, where information can be passed to another neuron. At the synapse, the electrical message is transformed into a chemical message, and these chemicals are neurotransmitters. As a chemical reaction prompted by an electrical signal, neurotransmitters bind or latch onto receptors, readying certain neurons to become available to receive information. As mentioned, our bodies naturally create opioids in the form of endorphins. In fact, these endorphins are a type of neurotransmitter, and our neurotransmitters have corresponding receptors. When it comes to neurotransmitters and the receptors, think of it as a lock and key. The key, our neurotransmitter, in this case some opioid chemical, be it an endorphin or a drug like fentanyl, fits into one lock, our specialized opioid receptor, known as the mu opioid receptor. When the mu receptor has a corresponding key, it creates a reaction in the brain. Normally, this reaction is triggered naturally by endorphins when we conduct pleasurable activities designed to keep us alive, such as eating and This reaction activates the mesolimbic pathway, also known as the reward system in the brain, that then releases dopamine. This reaction is what causes feelings of pleasure when either endorphins are released or after consuming an opioid-based drug. Opioids, when taken recreationally and even if taken as prescribed by a doctor, can result in or lead to addictive behavior. According to researchers, withdrawal from opioids is the main reason for why people become dependent upon the drug. They argue that repeated usage of any opioid drug alters the brain. Alterations occur when people develop a tolerance to the drug, due to the fact that neurons receiving opioid information from the mu receptor become less responsive. Thus, more of the drug is needed to get the same amount of dopamine released. Another notable brain change occurs when one develops a dependency on opioids. This change takes place in the locus coeruleus, or LC. The LC contains neurons responsible for the release of norepinephrine, and this helps regulate wakefulness, breathing, and blood pressure, among other things. Unfortunately, the release of norepinephrine relies on the mu receptor, but in a different way. Going back to our lock and key analogy, when the key isn't in the lock, our receptor is open. However, if the key is inserted into the lock, the receptor is blocked, therefore it's closed. Norepinephrine acts on the mu receptor, but it needs to be open. It's not a perfect fit, so it goes right through. Opioids perfectly fit into our mu receptor, closing it off to anything else. The brain, even at the neuronal level, is pretty plastic, so if there's repeated exposure to opioids, it makes adjustments. So the LC neurons increase their activity levels in order to maintain the release of normal levels of norepinephrine. When opioids are suddenly removed from the system, initially the excessive levels of norepinephrine are still being produced, resulting in anxiety, diarrhea, and muscle cramps. Also, it may result in decreased levels of dopamine release, once enjoyable activities are no longer so, at least during this withdrawal period. This means the dependence upon opioids really is about maintaining normal bodily functions. Addiction is characterized by all of the symptoms of dependence: prolonged use, tolerance buildup, and withdrawal symptoms from stopping the drug, plus the inability to stop using despite the consequences. Addiction to opioids may produce long-term alterations to the brain, and these long-term changes may be responsible for relapses or returning to using the drug after having detoxed and been separated from the drug for a substantial amount of time. For instance, permanent damage to the prefrontal cortex, the area of the brain responsible for higher order processing and executive functioning like judgment, planning, and impulse control, has been attributed to heroin addiction. In fact, there's evidence that points to prefrontal cortex damage pre- and post-addiction. Individuals likely to become addicted may also have prefrontal cortex damage that then is further damaged by the drug. Now that you understand the neurobiological mechanisms behind opioid abuse, it's important that addiction and dependence is viewed as a chronic medical condition, especially if we are really interested in ending the opioid epidemic that's currently taking place in the United States. There's a clear biological basis to what people struggling with opioid addiction experience, and drug dependence and addiction of any kind doesn't make anyone struggling with drug usage a bad or weak person. They just happen to have a brain that may be predisposed to addictive behaviors due to a damaged or underdeveloped prefrontal cortex, along with normally functioning release of neurotransmitters that tried to compensate for decreased release once the drug was introduced to their system. If you found this episode particularly informative, please subscribe to our channel and make sure to hit that like button. As always, thank you for watching.